morning and welcome. It's good to have you here. I am John Eby, a resident at Landis Homes. I may say some things that are controversial this morning, and I would like your response. If you would like a copy, email, write, or call me. Today is the 4th of July, a day we celebrate the time we became an independent nation with the goal of becoming a democracy, as President Lincoln described, of the people, by the people, and for the people. And we are still working at that, particularly how to make reality of all the people. This is also early in the process to select the next group of leaders for our national government. This has always been one of my favorite holidays. As a boy, I planted small American flags in our front yard in Lititz. This may surprise you, since my father was a Lancaster Conference Mennonite minister, and he approved. One of my proudest experiences was when I was chosen to be one of the heralds who played the trumpet fanfare to announce the arrival of the 4th of July Queen down the hill to the bandshell in the Lititz Springs Park. I played in various 4th of July parades as a member of the Lititz High School band. In school, I said the Pledge of Allegiance and prayed the Lord's Prayer. Occasionally, I read the scripture to start the day. On July 4th, our family always drove to one of the high spots around Lititz to watch fireworks. To protest the Vietnam War, sometimes I did not stand when the national anthem was played at sporting events. I do now. More recently, I have fed my photography habit by taking photographs of fireworks. One of my favorites is a photoshopped one with reflections in the Susquehanna River of the Pennsylvania State Capitol and the explosions overhead. I grew up with a perspective which I still hold that includes what I think is an appropriate kind of patriotism and loyalty to my country and its flag. I am aware of the sin of Christian nationalism and the possibility that patriotism and the flag can be co-opted and desecrated by groups such as those of the January 6th insurrection. When people misuse it, the flag can become an idol. I have on the hutch in my apartment a display of flags which our family has had connections. Botswana, Rwanda, Kenya, Tanzania, the United States, and the United Nations. And I have that one to remind me that our country is one of many, each with loyal citizens and different interests and needs. Today I want to celebrate the 4th of July by reminding us of some of the things the Bible suggests should guide our relationship to our country. I will read from Romans 13 from the Message by Eugene Peterson. Paul wrote in a situation of peace, but certainly not to a situation like our modern democratic situation. The Message says for Romans 13, be a good citizen. All governments are under God insofar as there is peace and order. It's God's order. So live responsibly as a citizen. If you're responsible to the state, if you're irresponsible to the state, then you're irresponsible with God. And God will hold you responsible. Duly constituted authorities are only a threat if you're trying to get by with something. Decent citizens should have nothing to fear. Do you want to be on good terms with the government? Be a responsible citizen, and you'll get on just fine. The government working to your advantage. But if you're breaking the rules, right and left, watch out. The police aren't there just to be admired in their uniforms. God also has an interest in keeping order, and he uses them to do it. That's why you must live responsibly, not just to avoid punishment, but also because it's the right way to live. That's also why you pay taxes, so that in an orderly way of life can be maintained. Fulfill your obligations as a citizen, pay your taxes, pay your bills, respect your leaders. That certainly is a very positive picture of government. Romans 13 suggests that the function of government, not necessarily any particular government, has been established by God and requires an appropriate level of submission. The New Revised Standard Bible says, "Let every person be subject to the governing authority, for there is no authority except from God, and those authorities that exist have been instituted by God." Of course, though the principle of authority may be instituted by God, some governments do not come close to meeting God's intentions for how they should govern for the good of all the people. And that leads to the second principle. The second principle grows from the experience of Jesus. When asked if his followers should pay taxes, Jesus replied, "Give therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." For me, this suggests that Christians should show an appropriate loyalty and support for government. Government has a responsibility to maintain justice and to do things that benefit all of us, that are best done together. But there are limits. In every case, loyalty to God and obedience to Jesus comes first, and may at times require resisting government. Some of us would put killing to protect our country in that category of things to be resisted. Or our responsibility might include trying to change government. We lived in Botswana, South Africa, Southern Africa, when South Africa still had apartheid. And that was one system that we resisted. And the people there did as well, many of them. The Apostle Paul wrote the following to Timothy, recorded in 1 Timothy 2, 1 and 2. "I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peacefully and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness." That implies a role for government to work for peace and justice, and a role for us to pray for political leaders. One of the most dramatic pictures of Jesus has him weeping over the city of Jerusalem, Luke 19, 41 to 44. "As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, 'If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and them on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you, and they will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God.'" I can imagine Jesus weeping over our country and our world. The things that make for peace include just laws and other political actions which produce justice. They include policies that promote individual flourishing economically and socially. The things which make for peace include how the system treats poor people, widows, and immigrants, and minorities. Maybe it even includes a preferential option for the poor. Maybe even laws to correct injustices of the past and actions that compensate for past wrongs. The prophet Micah wrote, "He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." And he was not alone. Amos, Jeremiah, Samuel, Malachi, in fact, a whole section of the Old Testament was devoted to prophets calling for kings, government, if you will, to work for justice and righteousness. Part of the reason Jesus was crucified was because he critiqued the power structure and injustice in his society. Luke 4:18 says clearly why Jesus came. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are oppressed." That's not a reassuring message to those who profit from injustice. We are fortunate to live in a democracy. This 4th of July, I would suggest that we celebrate an appropriate respect and loyalty to our government, and that we pray for it and call it to act justly and righteously, and that we work to support policies and programs which care for those in the margins and that promote inclusion for those the system has excluded. To reach that goal, we must select leaders who reflect righteousness and justice and integrity in their personal lives and in the policies they promote. This 4th of July, let's commit ourselves as Christians to be the kind of forces in our society that work to build justice and righteousness, and that do include the all people that President Lincoln talked about. Let's pray. Our God, today we do pray for our leaders and all leaders throughout the world. Call them to know how to work for righteousness and justice, and give them, to the extent that you can, the willingness and eagerness to do that. We also pray for Christians in all parts of our world, in our country where we have relative freedom and openness to practice our faith, in those countries where there is not that freedom and where people are suffering persecution for their faith. Give them strength. Give them the ability to persevere and the wisdom to know when and how to resist the pressures against them. And we pray for peace in the areas of our world where there's conflict, particularly in Ukraine and Sudan and other places. Be with your people in those situations. Give them strength and wisdom to do the kinds of prophetic ministry that you would call them to. And in our country, where we are struggling to find ways to compensate for some of the evils and sins that have characterized our country in the past, give us wisdom to know how to do that and how to open opportunities for all people. Give our leaders not only wisdom, but prior to that, a commitment to lead the country in the way you want us to go. And as we celebrate the 4th of July, thank you for putting us into this place where we have the freedoms we do. Guide us and direct us as we become your ministers for peace and justice in our setting. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.